you are all doing well. My name is Celeste, and if you are new to this channel, welcome. If you are not new to this channel, welcome back. So today, I just wanted to kind of do a little overview of all the things that I read in February of 2023. In total, I read 5 books to completion. I have one book that is literally on like 80%, and I just could not force myself to read it in time, and we'll get into why. So we're just gonna get into it. A lot of these books, I think I only read one physical book. All of them this month have been audiobooks. I did a lot of driving. So the first book of February that we were going to be talking about is The Final Girl Support Group by Grady Hendrix. And I ended up giving this book a 4 out of 5 stars for a couple reasons. Let's do a short summary first of Final Girl Support Group. It follows our main character, Lynette, who is a final girl, and she is in a support group full of final girls. And they are all very reminiscent of the slasher films of the 80s. We've got some nods to, well, I would say 80s and 90s. We've got some nods to Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Scream, a bunch of other ones that I can't really think of off the top of my head. I didn't really write all of them down. And essentially, Lynette is obviously very traumatized from her, from what made her a final girl. And this kind of dictates how she lives her life. She's kind of a hermit. She has ridiculous security parameters all around her house. She is very cautious everywhere she goes. And this all comes to a head when someone out there, we don't know who until obviously the very end, is out there trying to kill all of these final girls. So it's kind of it reads like a classic slashers movie, but now it's a slasher book, I guess. And I did enjoy the book. You know, I listened to it. It was a little bit hard to keep my interest at times, specifically towards the middle, where it kind of was just like, okay, can we move on with the story? Like, I'm getting a little bored. And I do think Lynette, obviously, she survived something so horrible. So, yes, she is going to have some trauma. But there were times where I was just like, Lynette, oh my God, why are you doing this? I'm getting so fed up with you. And it took me a little bit. Like, I needed some time. I needed breaks in between these chapters to, like, reason with why she is the way she is. And I think just ultimately it wasn't my favorite Grady Hendrix book. It was just a little too slow for me at times. The end really picked up, but I will say the ending wasn't really my favorite either, which I think took off a star for me. But like any other Grady Hendrix book, there is some gore, there's some horror in there, there's some, you know, goosebump, toe curling, like gag worthy moments where you're just reading or listening to these scenes and you're like, you can envision it. And I think that's I would still recommend this book to a lot of people. I think it just wouldn't be the first Grady Hendrix book I recommend to someone. Last month I read the Southern Book Club's Guide to Slaying Vampires. I still think that is top tier for me when it comes to his books. But still a good book overall. Maybe not just my cup of tea. Not a 5-star read for me, I would say. But still 4 stars. That's still good. That's still good. The next book that I finished from February is the only physical book that I read. And that is The Crown of Gilded Bones by Jennifer Armentrout. And I actually started tabbing. Look. Wow. I actually started tabbing this book, and I still really want to do a full in-depth video of all 4 books that are out right now. I think this is going to be a 6-book series, and I am almost done with The War of Two Queens. but I just couldn't get myself to finish it. So that video will come out probably in March, this month. I ended up giving it a 3.5 stars. Now, if you recall, last month I gave Kingdom of Flesh and Fire, which is the second book in the series, like a hard 4.5. I loved it. And I don't know how else to say this, but I think the series is like really waning on me. And this book, I don't think that this book was terrible. Okay, I don't think it was the worst book I've ever read. Okay, there's definitely plenty of books that I've read and hated. But it just felt so repetitive, and I think that's just an overall criticism of this series, is that it's just starting to really repeat itself in terms of its characters. I just didn't see a lot of character development as much character development as I would have wanted. Obviously, the plot is moving forward, but it's just kind of like, I don't know. If I had to sum up this series in, like, a short little blurb, I would just have to say it's literally, like, Poppy and Castiel, like, being in each other's pants all the time. Castiel being like, I don't deserve you. And Poppy being like, shut up. No, yeah, you do. Oh, my God. I think I'm a god, but I'm not a god. And I really need to just take a 23andMe test, because then this series would not need to be 6 books long. And that's kind of just what it is. And there's wolves and vampires, whatever, in this book. And that's really all I'm going to say about it. Because, again, I really want to do just a full video on it. A short summary of this. Essentially, Poppy is now the queen of Atlantia, the queen of Solace, who's like the blood queen, wants her back, obviously, because she's like their maiden, and that's really the whole story plot. That's literally it. And then at the end, we get like a huge cliffhanger, as always. That's all I'm gonna say about this book. That's it. Next book that I read, I listened to, was How to Sell a Haunted House by Grady Hendrix. I ended up rating this book a 4 out of 5 stars. I enjoyed it. I did, again, kind of similar to Final Girl Support Group, need some time in between the chapters, so I didn't read it as fast as I would have liked, but overall, I thought it was a really good story. I really loved the underlying themes of trauma, generational trauma, and how it surfaces in our relationships with our family. I think Louise and Mark's dynamic was really interesting to look at from two basically estranged siblings. Just a short overview of what this book is about. It follows two estranged siblings, Louise and Mark, who are now grappling with the fact that both of their parents have tragically passed in a car accident. And now they have to deal with all of the leftover baggage that their parents left, as well as, you know, just the general things that come with someone that you love and you're close to passing, wills, selling a house, except this house is just horrifically haunted by puppets. And that's the story without any spoilers. Again, there was only one physical book that I actually listened or read this month, so I listened to a lot of these scenes, but I think in terms of body horror and just sheer gore, I think of the 3 Grady Hendrix books that I've read so far, this one is definitely the most graphic. Spoilers right now if you haven't read this book, but the scene where Pupkin is like attacking Louise and he's on Mark's arm and Louise has to chop off his arm. I was driving home from work and I almost threw up in my car. It was just like, I couldn't, just the way that like he described it, and it was like well written. That's the thing. It's well written, obviously, because if it wasn't, I wouldn't have that visceral reaction, but oh my God. Whew, that was tough. Poppy at the end, well, towards like the third act, when she like made Pupkin after they thought that they got rid of him. Oh my god. I was in Walmart. I was grocery shopping and I had to like go to an aisle where no one else was and just kind of stand there and like I was like, no way. Because I knew something else is gonna have to happen because there's still like an hour or two of this book. Oh my god. It was so good. I loved it. And the way that it was left off. It definitely just felt like it was just like grieving your family, like a loved one, on extremely hard mode, on grounded mode, essentially. It was good. It was good. I would recommend it. Again, not my favorite Grady Hendrix book, but I definitely think it was worth the wait. It was worth all that anticipation. Yeah, I don't know. I loved it. I would definitely give it a reread too, just to kind of see all the little things that might have been placed that I didn't catch before. It was so good. I loved it. next book, and these books I actually finished within like the last week, so they're still really fresh. I feel like those first two books, Final Girl Support Group and Crown of Gilded Bones, I finished those within the first week of February, so they feel very like out of my brain. I don't know if anyone else has this, but like I feel like I have post-read amnesia. Like I read a book and I'm like, oh my god, that was so good, and then like an hour later I forget everything that happened. I don't know. It doesn't really fare well when I make these videos too, because I'm like, I don't know what the fuck I read. So I read, or I listened to, Daisy Jones and the Six by Taylor Jenkins Reid, and I ate that shit up. I started it, so it's Friday now. Okay, it's March 3rd, so it's a Friday. Last Friday, okay, I started Daisy Jones and the Six. It's like a 9-hour audiobook. I listened to it on my way to work, which is like a good 40 minutes. I listened to it on my way home, another 40 minutes. So, okay, like an hour and some down. Then on Friday night, I did some baking. I made some cinnamon rolls by scratch. So there's a lot of time that you have to put into that, like proofing time. And I just felt like I knocked the shit out of it. Like, I listened to probably like 60% of it on Friday. And then on Saturday, I finished it. So, I think for audiobook form, I don't think there's a better book to listen to as an audiobook, maybe even for the first time if you're not an audiobook listener, because the format of the book is so, like, it's so well put for both reading and listening. A little bit of an overview, a summary. This book follows a popular, I think, 1970s band titled Daisy Jones and the Six. It includes their rise to fame, all the way up to their, you know, best-selling album called Aurora. It details how the band, you know, had all their trials and tribulations with each other, and also their subsequent fall from grace. So it is an interview form. And it's kind of, so the way that it is all the band members are getting their individual interviews, like, I think it's like 30 years later, they're older. And they're kind of retrospectively talking about the band. And, I don't know, it was great to listen to, because it felt like I was just listening to like a really long documentary, about a band. And I don't know, it was just so good. It was a 5-star read. I rated that 5 stars. And before I move on to the last book, all of you Daisy and Billy shippers, we are Billy and Camila here. Billy and Camila forever. Okay, last book, and I literally just finished this, and I'm still reeling from it. This was like the last book of February, so it's still so fresh, and it's such a fresh wound, and that is The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo. And if you've read that book, you know why it's such a fresh wound. A short summary. It's also by Taylor Jenkins Reid, and it also kind of takes on a bit of an interview-esque format, except it's a lot more, takes some more liberties in terms of the descriptions. Jesus, what the hell? Takes a little bit more liberties in terms of, you know, the way that Evelyn describes her life rather than like pure interview form like Daisy Jones and the Six was. And it just kind of is a biography of this fictional actress named Evelyn Hugo and her rise to fame as a actress in Hollywood from the 1950s all the way up until like modern day. It chronicles all seven of her husbands, her great loves, and it made me cry a lot. Like, a lot.
Back at Frankie, trying to confirm to whom exactly she's talking, I point to myself. Do you mean me? Frankie has very little patience. Yes,
That twist at the end of Monique's dad? What? Did not see that coming. So, like, with the audiobooks, I always, like, look and see how many chapters there are, just because I'm curious, and I do that with physical books, too. And it says it has the headings of, like, the husbands and, like, the last heading, or again, spoiler, where it says the life and death of Evelyn Hugo, and I was like, oh, that's, like, the big thing, is that she's just gonna die at the end. And that was not what it was, because the entire, like, book, Evelyn's like, no, Monique, don't defend me because you're not going to like me at the end of this interview process. And I was like, oh, it's because she's going to die. And Monique's going to be like, why did you die on me? Like, that's so mean. I don't know. Fucking, I thought that was going to be totally not what it was. And I was so happy to be caught off guard. I love a plot twist that I don't accidentally, like, spoil for myself because I'm terrible at not spoiling things for myself. Just, I think I hold these characters very dearly to my heart. That's all I gotta say about this. I am so sad to leave them. Like, I don't want to be done with the book. But I also, like, want the conclusion. So good. I guess I have to talk about this book. The last book that I have is The War of Two Queens by Jennifer Armentrout. That one, I'm literally, like, it's right here. Because I was reading it last night. I am literally, you can't even see, that much. Do you see that? I could not get myself to read all of it in February. I was like, I can't. I have had the hardest time. I have had the hardest time getting myself to read this book because it is so monotonous and, like, boring. I'm skimming the shit out of it, too. Like, I think there's, like, 600 and some pages, and I'm on, like, 475. Oh, my God. Poppy and Castile are annoying the shit out of me. I'm just like, get over yourselves. We get it. You're in love. Whatever. Shut up. Kill someone or something. Make it interesting. I don't know. We'll see towards the end, like, when I finish it and make that video finally, how I feel, but I have a feeling I know how it's gonna end. This is my prediction for how the book's gonna end, okay? In the last 100 and some pages, we'll say like 50. The joining is gonna happen because I already know it's gonna happen because people have been talking about it. Because Poppy's gonna be like, I have to save Castiel and Kieran from fucking Isbeth, and this is the only way, is to have sex with both of them at the same time. Which I'm like, cool, whatever, do whatever you want. But at the same time, like, I don't really care at this point anymore. I've skipped a lot of the spice. It's just the same over and over again. Then they're gonna go find, I think it's Malek. There's a pronunciation guide, I should probably use it. Malek. They're gonna go find Malek, who is, like, the demigod, or I think he's a god. He's a god. And was presumed to be Poppy's dad, but he's not. It's his twin brother. And, they're gonna go find him, and he's gonna be like, I'm gonna kill that bitch. And, that's gonna be the strife for the next book. Or it's just gonna end when they awaken him. When they unentomb him. That's my guess. Okay? We'll come back and see, okay? When I do my overall video, we'll see if I was right. If I missed anything. If it truly deserves to not be a projected 2.53 stars. That's what it feels like right now. If it can redeem itself, I'm all for it. I would love for this book to pick up the pace, but yeah. That's what I read in February, guys. An interesting month of books, right? A fantasy series that is really winding me down. Two just romance period pieces and two horror books. Such a great February, right? Okay, that's really all I had for you. I wanted to make this nice and quick. I didn't even put any notes down. I didn't write anything for this, you know? I'm just fucking raw-dogging it. If you like this video, like it. If you like my videos, subscribe. And tell me what you read in February and what you thought about any of these books if you've read them. And follow me on all my social medias. Peace.